Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jabro, the Director of Portfolio Management at Dricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Dricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Jason Turner, Chief Investment Strategist of Great Lakes Advisors. He is a member of the firm's investment committee, authors market and economic commentary, regularly presents in the media and to professional conferences, and works with client portfolio managers to support institutional and private clients. As the head of multi-asset strategy, he is responsible for portfolio strategy, asset allocation, and for overseeing the firm's manager due diligence and selection efforts. He is also a member of the firm's operating committee and management committee. After 2020 gave us the most significant economic slowdown since the Great Depression, 2021 saw a rapid economic recovery in the first half of the year, followed by a rapidly shifting landscape in the later half of the year. Many questions and concerns have risen from the economic experience in the last year. In today's Industry Insider webinar, we'll provide an update on the economic and market outlook for a post-COVID world. Jason will provide insights into how we arrived at the current condition, what economic data is telling us about the current environment, and what could influence the direction of economic growth in 2022 and beyond. Please utilize the chat feature if you have any questions during the presentation. And with that, I will turn the floor over to Jason.
All right, thank you, Amanda. And thank you all for being with us today. As you heard in the introduction, I'll be presenting you a market and economic update. And as dry as that may sound, I promise to make it as interesting as possible and filled with nuggets of information you can take with you. And in fact, we decided today to offer you a bit of a theme. So instead of a dry economic presentation, we're gonna have 12 reflections for Christmas. Obviously, I don't have gifts for you, and we're 9 days away from the start of these 12 days of Christmas on the 25th, but I'll use the 12 days of Christmas as an inspiration to walk you through some observations on the economy and markets and some thoughts about what may occur in 2022. And that landscape is ever shifting, as we saw with this week's Fed and Bank of England announcements as well. So we will spend some time walking through 12 items that I think are of highly interesting note for the economy and markets. And we will start with our partridge in a pear tree, or our global pandemic moving into year three. And I promise that's the only one I think I rhymed in the group, and I promise not to sing. But the global pandemic moving into year three, is we've seen an uptick here in COVID infections, really what amounts to a fourth wave built not quite yet on the Omicron variant, but very likely to be as we move into the next few months. One thing we've noticed as we've moved through each of these successive waves of higher infection rates with the global pandemic is less and less impact from an economic lockdown perspective. That first wave that occurred early in 2020, really stretching into the first part of the summer, saw a near total shutdown of the American economy, the global economy to boot. As we moved through a summer wave and then another wave the winter months and the Delta wave that occurred here mid-year, we saw less and less economic impact. I think we've learned as a society how to coordinate our way around virus restrictions to keep things chugging along from an economic perspective. By no means does that mean we did not see slowdown in economic activity. We certainly did with the Delta variant, with the GDP expectations at the beginning of the third quarter near 7% and the realized GDP at the end of the quarter near 2%, there certainly was economic impact. But that's certainly not the 33% decline in economic activity we saw in the second quarter of 2020. So less of an impact from the pandemic moving forward. However, we are moving into the third year of the global pandemic and are likely to see continued impact from the pandemic as we move forward into 2022. The question will be how well the economy moves through that next wave. And I've gone the wrong direction. Let's do this. Our two turtle doves for this morning, or this afternoon, I should say, are two American political parties. And this is one thing that we looked a lot at before the pandemic as being a factor impacting markets. And we're starting to look at, obviously, again, with the amount of partisanship and differences between the two political parties. In fact, measured on polarization, the number of votes strictly along party lines, going back to the end of the Civil War through today, we have never seen the House and Senate more polarized than they are now. And you can see in the chart on the left, the distance to which the Democratic Party is spread out and the distance to which the Republican Party is marched more and more to the right and actually become more coalesced around a center point farther right than they were in 1980. As we've seen this gulf exist between the two political parties, we have both short and long-term impacts for the economy and markets. Frankly, markets like when the government stays out of their business. So polarization leading to inactivity in the government means likely the markets to see a little bit better performance because they won't be disrupted by policy changes. However, long-term economic growth tends to face a pretty significant headwind from polarization, as we could see by looking at the time periods where we've had low polarization versus high polarization or increasing polarization, that typically slows economic activity. Why? There's less fiscal and government support for moving gross domestic product forward. We are a consumer-focused economy, certainly, here in the United States. However, government spending and government support for consumers goes a long way to furthering economic development. And as we've seen with the arguments around the infrastructure bill or bills that have been proposed this year, something that both parties actually trumpeted as part of their platform in 2016 during the 2016 elections, $1 trillion in infrastructure spending, took months to get a first round of spending agreed to and still a second round hanging out there. So the continued impact of the two political party systems here in America have long-term economic potential headwinds should we stay at the same level of polarization that we see today. And by no means is it a coincidence that we picked the turtle doves for the Republicans and Democrats. Our three French hens for today are 3 million missing workers. And this is something I don't have to point out to business owners or those involved in business on today's call. We saw a significant drop in labor force participation right after the economic lockdowns began relative to the pandemic. That shutdown saw nearly 3.5% of the American workforce disappear from the labor force. And what does it mean to be in the labor force? Well, it means you're either employed or you meet the definition of unemployed. And to meet the definition of unemployed, you actually have to be looking for work. That typically is the thing that takes folks out of the labor force. They're not looking, although you must be available as well. So those that are sick and unable to work also excluded from the workforce. We saw a pretty quick spike back in the summer months of 2020 in labor force participation. We would have expected to see a gradual return to full participation, and the return has been much more gradual than expected and in fact has stalled out for large portions of the last 18 months. We are currently stuck just below 62% in terms of labor force participation. Well, what does that mean? That actually adds up to just about those 3 million workers we're missing. Why do I say 3 million workers are missing? We have roughly 7 million unemployed, 11 million open positions, just shy of 11 million open positions, meaning a gap, if you will. If every single person who was looking for a job and found a fit, we'd still be 3 million workers short of meeting all of the job openings. And why is a key factor. Many would have said that the transfer payments from the government, extended unemployment benefits and stimulus checks would have been the major reason. And those should have evaporated in September when those extended unemployment benefits also ended. However, as you can see by this survey from the Indeed Hiring Lab, that was never higher than fifth in terms of the reasons why individuals were not working. We've seen it move from COVID fears to a reason we haven't seen here in the United States in some 40 years, and that's my spouse is employed, meaning we are content to be single earning households for now. The financial cushion from rising asset prices, and we have seen asset prices rise significantly since the emergence from the lockdowns, particularly in the stock market. That financial cushion, whether it be from those stimulus checks or more likely from rising asset prices, has been another major factor in keeping folks out of the employment market. and excluded from the labor force. The other one, and we saw this coming out of 08 and 09, give people time on the sidelines, and those care responsibilities, either for children or the elderly, tend to pile up and become concerns for them going back to work. And as that focus shifts to the home from the job, people become rooted in that disposition and hesitate in returning to the labor force. And not shown here, we're anticipating in similar surveys that between 1 to 3 and 3 to 6 months is the likely period many of these individuals will start looking for work. So that means after the first of the year, we should start to see a trickling of individuals coming back towards the labor force that lasts potentially around 6 months. Now, at the same time, we're seeing some deciding on early retirement or a demographic trend, meaning a shrinking of the labor force that is occurring thanks to American demographics that will also coincide. We saw this result out of 2008 and 2009 as well. So we will not get the 3 million missing workers back, but we will get some of them back through the first half of next year. And that's important for businesses as they start to plan and try to meet hiring needs, as those hiring needs remain quite advanced. Our 4 calling birds is the calling card of 4% unemployment, long considered to be the natural rate of unemployment. And it sounds strange to call unemployment a natural rate, but there is some amount of friction, individuals moving in and out of jobs that will contribute to the unemployment rate. Also, there's a misfit. So we need individuals working in these 3 industries, but those that are on the unemployment rolls currently work in these other industries. So there's a matter of retraining or restructuring the needs in labor force. And then there's geographic concerns. We need employees in California. We have a bunch of people in Nebraska looking for work. In those type of misfits, there will always be some natural level of unemployment. And the Fed has long postulated about 4% is the lower bound. Right now, they're thinking about 3.8% represents full employment. That gets us back to the level we were at before the pandemic. But it also underscores that at 4.2%, we're almost there. Now, let's take those 3 million missing workers into the equation as well, and that pushes our unemployment rate up closer to 7% if they were all looking for work at the same time. So there still is some more room to fill open positions. However, those open positions did persist before the pandemic. We actually had about 7 million open positions at the end of 2019 before the pandemic even began. So we've been seeing a bit of a labor shortage emerging in the United States for the last 6 or so years leading up to the pandemic. And the pandemic, of course, has now exacerbated that with the additional individuals on the sidelines and not included in the labor force. Our 5 gold rings, and I keep clicking away. There, our 5 gold rings represent 5% wage growth. So while employment is at 4%, we've seen wages grow just south of 5%. On a average hourly earnings year over year basis. In real terms, because of where inflation sits, that means it's actually a 1.2% pay cut in real terms, meaning there is more room for wages to appreciate. You can see this orange line here on the chart has typically existed above 0, meaning wage growth typically outpaces inflation. We have not seen that occur in this turbulent period here post and emerging from the pandemic. So we would assume that average hourly earnings, our wages, if you will, would increase at a faster rate to meet and likely overshoot inflation. Every time these two get involved in a spiral, there is always a trade-off and generally an overshoot by wages catching up or inflation catching up to large wage growth if we've gone the other direction. They will find equilibrium at some point, but we are likely to see the need for employers to raise wages into 2022 to continue to A, meet the shortfall in job openings and hirings, and B, meet worker demands. Workers are certainly starting to demand and ask for compensation to meet the rising cost of living, pointed to by our next item, and that's our 6 Giesel laying or 6% inflation being laid across the economy. Most recent print update on CPI was the end of last week at 6.8%. That represents the highest rate of inflation since the early 1980s on a core basis, so exclude food and energy. And I know we all buy food and all spend money on energy, particularly gasoline for cars. So those are maybe silly things to exclude, but they are volatile things. So many economists and the Fed included like to look at a core rate of inflation, and that core CPI is up nearly 5%. The Fed prefers what they call the PCE price index, personal consumption expenditures price index. That's a mouthful for the money you and I spend in the economy. Two key differences between CPI and PCE. Number one is the concept of substitution. That's an important concept for us as economists. Substitution means if you go to a new car lot and there are no new cars to buy, you still need a car, you're going to pivot and you're either going to spend more on public transportation or you're going to buy a used car. And we have certainly seen those trade-offs occur in decision-making over the course of the last 2 years. PCE accounts for those substitution changes and says there are more used cars being sold than new cars. We'll pivot the amount of the basket, the contribution of used cars versus new cars. The other piece that it takes into account, CPI is based on a survey of individuals. And as much as we'd like to believe we're a nation of very, very honest people, generally speaking, you put somebody in an anonymous survey and it is a little easy to stretch the truth on the margins and say, yeah, I spent money on a new boat last year. So CPI is based on that survey. PCE is based on actual business receipts. So actual expenditures filter into PCE. So the Fed likes that number better. That number is a little bit lower. Why? It tends to be a little more dominated by services in that piece. So up about 4% on the core PCE basis. Still one of the highest numbers we have seen there in decades. Our seven swans of swimming for today are the $7 trillion in currently committed and potential fiscal stimulus from the U.S. government. This includes those unemployment benefits and stimulus checks, but also tax changes, tax credits, and infrastructure spending, either that has been announced and or proposed. We'll see, though, in the course of 2021, a significant percentage of support, nearly 8%, from all of these relief and fiscal stimulus items. That will quickly dwindle and already started, has started to do so here in late 2021, continue to dwindle through 2022 and level off in 23 and 24 as we get to more of those spending and infrastructure benefits, roughly a 1.75%, 2% benefit to GDP. So not an extreme amount of tailwind to further significant additional inflation in terms of what's promised down the road. However, what's already been committed certainly is contributing to the inflation we're seeing work its way through the economy. Our base case then, given that fiscal stimulus is not likely to have a significantly meaningful impact on inflation, we do anticipate that inflation will continue to increase into the beginning part of 2022. Some of that is a delayed impact for some of the spending that has been committed. Some of it is also elements of inflation or consumer price indexes that haven't been factored in as greatly as they normally would be. And I'm pointing directly to shelter costs. Shelter costs are notorious for having a 12 to 18 month delay in their incorporation into inflation numbers. We're only just starting to see them tick up above 3%. And as we all well know, home prices increased more than 3% in the last 18 months. So we will see those work their way through what's called owner's equivalent rent into the inflation numbers early next year. In addition to the supply chain disruptions we have seen have not abated. They have not been mitigated away yet. They will likely find ways to solve themselves as we move forward, either through decreased demand or continued improvement in supply chain conditions. However, that proposition does take time to fulfill. So that's the outlook on inflation, even with the additional fiscal stimulus committed. Our eight maids of milking, or 8 months of declining consumer sentiment. Consumer sentiment has been a key that I've been watching since the beginning of the pandemic to let us know when we've really started to emerge from a consumer confidence perspective. Consumer confidence is important because 70% of the economy is made up of the money you and I spend in the economy. And half of that, 70%, actually upwards of now 70%, is the money we spend on services as opposed to goods. However, that dynamic did get shifted around a bit during the pandemic, and we'll look at that in a moment. From a consumer sentiment perspective, it's when do consumers get off the sidelines and resume the spending patterns that were the hallmark of the American economy before the pandemic? And we've been watching closely the sentiment numbers, and a huge drop, of course, in 2020 as we entered into the pandemic era. We saw a gradual improvement into the beginning of 2021, but then through 2021, we have seen 8 straight months until this last preliminary print for December, 8 straight months of declining consumer sentiment, eventually actually reaching a level below where we were at the beginning of 2020, below where we were in the depths of the pandemic. consumers were less confident about the future direction of the economy. And that index of consumer expectations, the half of the survey that makes up those future pieces, is down here in orange. And you can see that individuals look at the current condition significantly better than the future condition. And the number one cited reason is inflation. Those impacts to my spending power, my ability to buy things in the economy, certainly are starting to add up as it relates to the consumer's confidence in the economy to come 6 to 12 months hence. Now, we did see an uptick in this number in the preliminary reading for December, and we'll get two more revisions of that number before the end of the month. So hopefully we hold on to those gains and kind of reverse that at 8 months of declines. But we're starting to see consumers either come to terms with this is the level of prices and I'm comfortable with it, or that some of the actions like the Fed announcement, with the Fed now committing to potentially 3 rate increases and a faster rate of tapering, could impact consumers' confidence in the economy on a go-forward basis. Our 9 ladies dancing are 9 months of supply disruption. So 1 month preceding that decline in consumer sentiment and driving a lot of it was disruption in the supply chain. And our supply chains normally, thanks to just-in-time inventory and the like, are stretched pretty thin. So it doesn't take much in the way of upset into apple carts to disrupt global supply chains. And we certainly saw that over the course of the last 18 months. We saw it most notably here in durable goods, those that are goods that last for more than 3 years. So not services, not non-durable goods, think refrigerators, think cars, think things that are big ticket purchases that individuals are going to buy and likely keep for a number of years. Non-durable goods like most grocery products and the like, or services, those things that aren't tangible goods, but that we pay for anyway, have not seen the runaway increase in terms of real personal consumption on those items. And this is just kind of a growth of 10,000 to get you the magnitude, but almost no change in services from where we sat emerging from the pandemic until now, but a 10+% increase in consumption of durable goods. So this is a demand-oriented push in addition to a limitation on supplies. Factories shut down, inventories were depleted. We saw that inventory depletion, and then we saw this big uptick in the beginning of 2021 as folks rushed out to buy things as they bought those big ticket items and then waited and waited and waited, as I did for the chairs that we bought last summer and that just showed up last week. We waited and waited and waited for those durable goods, but we certainly spent that money. And that has caused this supply chain disruption that has played into much of the inflationary pressures that we see right now. And for what it's worth, played a lot into the Fed's label of transitory that they applied for to inflation up until 2 weeks ago when Chair Powell told Congress he'd like to retire the word transitory as relates to inflation. Certainly appropriate as we move on to our 10 lords a-leaping, and that's the 10-year Treasury bond yield. And we keep an eye on the 10-year, that is the reference rate for a number of things, mortgages most importantly. And that 10-year typically gives us a good picture of the health of the American economy on a go-forward basis. The Fed controls the short end of the curve down here with the federal funds rate and then the follow-on impact in the shorter end. As we get out to the longer end of the yield curve, it becomes more indicative of the health of the, and growth of the American economy. And as the curve has started to flatten here with the Fed starting to come off of the dot and act, we're starting to see what we would call a bear flattening move in the curve, meaning that rates are coming up, expectations for the future are not moving at the same rate, so we're starting to see rates level off between the two a bit. Not concerning from a ring alarm bells perspective, but certainly something of note. We expect to see a lot of volatility, and thus this is why it's 10 lords a-leaping, a lot of volatility in Treasury rates moving forward. As the Fed policy continues to coalesce and as global central bank policy continues to coalesce, we'll start to see some differences, like we saw in the announcements from the Bank of England and the ECB. Bank of England announced today they're raising rates by 15 basis points. The ECB came out on the heels of that and effectively said they're not going to raise rates at all next year. So two very different messages from two central banks separated by a very small body of water in terms of the English Channel, but economies that are fairly close to each other or have traditionally been fairly close to each other in pre-Brexit times. So we'll continue to watch Treasury bond yields both in the short term and the long term to give us an idea of how much progress the Fed is making against the combat against inflation, but at the same time, what are the longer term growth implications for the American economy as we move hopefully back towards higher rates, which means maybe more stable economic growth, but at the same time, a little bit more normalized levels of supply and demand, and that helps the economy as a whole. If we move on then to our 11 drummers drumming, there are 11 sectors in the S&P 500 index. So the S&P 500 index is an index of stocks that equates to large cap US companies. And we break those down into 11 sectors. And you can see in green, the best performer, and in red, the worst performer in all of these time periods. So from a quarter to date perspective, for the last quarter through the middle of December here, the information technology sector, or technology stocks, have been far and away the best performer, with communication services the trailing factor. Now, technology is a high multiple, so it trades at a high multiple to earnings, growth companies, and this has actually been fairly concentrated in five or six of the largest technology names, making up most of the upside move in the market. If we widen that lens out, though, to the year-to-date or one-year periods, you see the energy sector, and this is probably no surprise as you watch the price of oil, the price of gas at the pump. Energy stocks have come roaring back in 2021 and are the runaway leaders in terms of performance. Now, this is also not to say that the broader market hasn't performed well, with the S&P 500 up over 27% over that same time period, and the worst performing sector being utilities up 15.4% on a year-to-date basis. Stock markets have reacted positively across the board. This trend of the rising tide lifting all boats, though, potentially starts to fade away as we move into 2022 and start moving forward. We've seen that disparity in prior years. So the three-year and five-year show us that technology stocks were up 40% or 31%, while energy companies were up, actually down 1% or down 2%. So a wider dispersion of returns in more normalized economic conditions. And we anticipate that to start to occur here in 2022 as we start to get a little bit more clarity on the path of rates, a little bit more clarity on the path of global central bank activity. It makes some of those higher valuation companies, both from a rising rate perspective, but also from an inflationary perspective, a little bit more troubled in terms of their return outlook. While older economy companies, those that either rely on rates like financial services or produce high levels of current cash flow like industrial companies, will likely perform better as we move forward and start to see market leadership rotate a bit. Now, that said, there are certainly some of those large technology companies that can weather these type of conditions, so that is not an all-encompassing statement. But as we watch the 11 S&P sectors drum on into 2022, we're expecting to see equity returns moderate. I would not say that you're going to see 27% returns year over year in the next several years. We're likely to see those come in significantly. However, we'll start to see some more dispersion in returns as well. And our 12 Pipers Piping, there are 12 members of the Federal Open Markets Committee. Those Fed governors and open market participants decide the path of interest rates. And as they did just this week, decided not to move rates, however, increased the taper. So my chart is already wrong from what I put together last night. The pace was $15 billion a month in terms of reducing the amount of purchases. So key to note, the Fed is still pushing monetary stimulus into the economy. They're still buying bonds in the open market. The rate at which they're buying those bonds, though, was to be slowed, announced at the November meeting, by $15 billion a month. They are now going to slow that by $30 billion a month. This moves this timeline significantly. So running into this week, the taper was going to proceed at $15 billion a month, end in June. The July Federal Open Market Committee meeting was the likely first rate increase, with a second increase in November. The market, however, since that announcement in November, has started to price in three rate moves in 2022, and the Fed has confirmed that is the likely direction they are to take next year. Now, the Fed has a get-out-of-jail-free card in terms of the Omicron variant. They can get more dovish if they need to as the Omicron surge starts to move, so we'll connect our 12 to our 1 there. But our estimation here, just drawing in words on this chart, would be the taper ends sometime in March at its current doubled pace. And we are likely to see then three rate increases, with the first one targeted then at April, then July and November, in terms of timing for those 25 basis point increases, likely ending the year with the federal funds rate at 75 basis points. The implication there for the 10-year means it moves to 2 to 2.25%, maybe even 2.5% by the end of 2022. And the Fed will, in terms of their potential future interest rate moves, or maybe three in 2023 and one in 2024, that would get them to their terminal rate on the Fed funds rate at 2.25 or 2.3%. But that is looking way into the future in terms of a crystal ball. And as the market will tell you, the Fed is never that great at forecasting its moves even 6 months out, much less 2 or 3 years out. So that's the anticipated path for the Fed, both in 2022 and going forward, to be determined, of course, the impact of the Omicron variant and the direction markets may paint for us to go. So that completes our 12 observations for Christmas, but I would be remiss if I didn't leave you with one nugget of information that could be a fun one for the holiday season. There is actually a Christmas price index out there that measures the cost of the 12 items from the 12 days of Christmas. And you can see that up on the screen now. In terms of that cost index, the cost of those items from the 12 days of Christmas from 2019 to 2021, because some of these items weren't even available in 2020. So there's a big disclaimer that the 2020 to 2021 comparables are not accurate. So we're looking at 2019 to 2021. The cost of buying the items in the 12 days of Christmas went up by 5.7%. If you bought one of each, it would cost you about $41,000, $41,205.58 to be exact. And the most expensive item out there are the seven swans of swimming. That's always the most expensive item in this price index, although the Lords of Leaping are starting to get a little pricey with nearly 13% inflation from those Lords in the last 2 years. Now, the true cost of all items, that number at the bottom is at 5.4%. This assumes that you buy in the same quantities that are articulated in the song each of the 12 days. So you're going to actually end up buying 364 items, I believe, for a cost of nearly $180,000. Not the Christmas present that most of us are going to run out and buy. But I thought I'd leave you with a little economic tie-in to the 12 days of Christmas. If there are questions, if there are any areas that I can dig into from a more specific perspective, I believe Amanda gave you the instructions before the presentation. But we will open it up for any of those questions at this point.
Okay, so go ahead and submit any questions that you have into the chat feature. And while attendees are doing that, Jason, can you give us some takeaways or items that we should be thinking about in preparation for the beginning of 22 with some of the items that you've covered today?
Sure. In terms of the 12 items I covered today are the more impactful ones, and we'll concentrate on unemployment and inflation for those. We would expect to continue to see gradual improvement in the unemployment rate moving into the beginning of 2022, but that's going to come at the expense of increased wages. So wages are going to continue to march higher, both to meet inflation, but also to meet worker demand. So that's an area we'll be watching closely. The thing we want to avoid there is what's called a wage price spiral, where wages will increase and will increase well in excess of inflation. And then inflation needs to increase because of demand to meet wages. And the two of them never seem to link up. And there would be this spiral that would look a little bit like the 1970s. What this looks a little bit more to us like is the post-World War II period, where you saw a number of Americans come back to the economy, a sharp increase in demand, and a supply infrastructure not yet ready to meet that increase in demand. And so the story for us in 2022, we're going to be watching the supply side and its ability to meet demand, and at the same time, watching demand moderate to an extent. I think we've seen a lot of folks sitting on a lot of pent-up spending. The savings rate has come down significantly, so a lot of that money that was on the sidelines has now been deployed. But we'll start to see some of that occur in Europe and other places that still have a lot of money on the sidelines. In terms of inflation, we're likely to see inflation continue to tick higher into the first part of next year. That's both these delayed impacts of shelter costs and the continued impact of supply chain disruption. So as we continue to see that march higher in the early part of next year, I would not get overly concerned with that being a economic disruptor. Over the course of 2022, we should see that crest and start to recede in terms of the price increases on a month over month or year over year basis. Although the break-even rate of inflation implied by the difference between the 5-year tips and treasury looks to be somewhere close to 3% for the next 5 years. So the thought would be, even if we end the year next year at 4% inflation, we're likely to see inflation still elevated for the next several years as some of these price changes gradually work their way through the economy. That means continued wage pressure to the north side. So, you know, wages keep pace with inflation in normal economic environments, and we would anticipate wages to continue to do so going forward. In terms of last nuggets, I wouldn't worry about further infrastructure spending. It'll be deployed over the course of 10 years, and we're not looking at that as a largely inflationary occurrence. We're actually looking at that as fairly supportive for economic growth going forward. I didn't touch on GDP growth during the 12 days, but the GDP growth estimates for next year call for slightly above trend growth in the United States, eventually moderating. We're going to get back to a condition where we're growing at about 2% and struggling to get inflation over 2% within the next 4 or 5 years, and it'll all feel kind of normal. But for the next year or so, higher inflation, more wage pressure, higher than trend growth, but markets will interpret all of that in terms of volatility, and we'll see some volatility in markets next year as well.
Wonderful. Thank you for covering that. I'll also go ahead and put up the disclosures as those are necessary. And we'll end the presentation today. If there are no additional questions, I'll put my contact information up. If you have any questions or would like additional information, you can certainly reach out to me. And with that, we'll conclude today's session. So thank you for participating, and Jason, for sharing your knowledge of economic and market outlook for the post-COVID world. And for everyone, please watch for information on our next webinar session. With that, I hope you have a wonderful day.